And a man that is a marvel of entertainment is Fred Applegate, who plays Max Bialystock, which is the big character in this for many reasons, and we'll talk about that next. Fred, thank you so much for coming in after a performance.
Oh, it's my pleasure.
How are you?
I'm good, but I'm not that big anymore because I've worked really hard in this show.
I mean, you've just done 3 hours of probably one of the most taxing physical roles for any lead, because you're on for most of it.
Okay, now I'm tired.
Yeah. I mean, the thing is with most shows, I mean, you go and see The Lion King. The Lion King's only on for like 3 minutes in the whole production. You guys come on at the beginning. You don't realize it until you watch the movie and you're actually sat there so intense and they're 2 feet away from you that you realize you don't get a minute to yourself, do you?
Not really. Not really. In fact, tonight we started a little Secret Santa gift exchange thing, and you hide the gifts around the theater for the other people who are playing, and I realized I don't have time to go find mine.
For those of you who don't know, the producers, if you've been hiding under a rock or something for the last 30 years, it was originally a film, and then they made it into a musical, and now they've made a film of the musical. So it's almost come full circle, and I was lucky enough to see a preview of this about a week ago, and it really is as funny the second, third, tenth, or in my case, about 30th time, cool, as it was the first. But there is something that does annoy me about this.
Uh-oh.
You know the big scene, and I don't want to give anything away, but the Springtime for Hitler scene, mm-hmm, I wish I could see that again for the first time like I did in the theatre, because there's something so magical about a dancing swastika. I'm not going to give any more away than that.
Yeah.
How does Mel Brooks get away with it?
I don't know. I think it's because he does all of this absurdity without any malice. It's just so stupid that you have to laugh. It's a little like being tickled. Eventually, you're gonna laugh.
From the minute this opens, it shocks and appalls, because for those who don't know, it's a story about finding the worst play ever written, because that will make him the most money. He finds out that he can make more money with a flop than with a hit.
Well, because if the show closes on opening night, we don't have to account for how we spent the money.
Exactly.
We figure then we can just steal it.
So he then has to look and find this most outrageous play, and he finds a play called Springtime for Hitler, which is about... Well, you explain.
Well, it's the full title of the play, as written by our Nazi playwright, is Springtime for Hitler, a gay romp with Adolf and Eva at Berchtesgaden. In a form of like a Busby Berkeley musical of the life of Hitler.
And it goes from bad to worse. We should say, if you are very, very sensitive about the war, and this is a true story, Fred, I went to see this in LA when it first opened with Gary Beach there and the people, and it was amazing. But sat next to me was a guy who was in the war, and he had tattooed up his arm and number and was appalled at me laughing. Not at the show so much as me laughing, because I was kind of young to him. Mm-hmm. So be aware that this is a comedy, and go in there with an open mind, because you could be offended. There's plenty to be offended by, isn't there?
Well, that's the beauty of Mel's work, is that there's so much to be offended by. It's hard to feel as though you were singled out. I really think that possibly the Mormons and the Chinese are the only ones who come away from this show with nothing to complain about.
Because, of course, the big story today is the gay marriage. It's on all the news, and we're running it in our news. And, of course, in this, you have a wonderful character. Tell us about the character that you go to see, because you want an amazing director, don't you?
Well, I want a director that fits in with my plan for the show. So we go see Roger Debris. And, you know, it's almost impossible to describe his entrance.
And, of course, he's played on Broadway by Gary Beach, who's also in the film. Mm-hmm. And this new film is great for me, because I interviewed most of these people years ago when it opened on Broadway, when I was making my shows for the BBC. And Mel's kept most of the original cast, which is so nice. I mean, you're in it. All the people mm-hmm. that were associated originally are in it. And that's really nice, because it would have been easy for him to just recast the whole thing, presumably.
Yeah, and what he did was not only the Broadway show, but both of the... first and second national tours, he sort of gave everybody a little part in the document of what we were part of. It was very sweet of him, and was really exciting. It was fun.
Do you ever get bored? Because I've spoken to actors before who say that being nasty can be quite good, because every night you can be nasty, but being funny every night is hard to keep it funny, because of course you've heard these jokes 10 billion times now. Mm-hmm. How do you work with that?
Part of it is I have so much confidence in the material. I mean, I know this stuff is funny, and if I don't screw up, it'll be fine. I mean, maybe I'll give myself a little more credit. Nah, I won't. But it's you know, Mel's material, and I just have to craft it and throw it out, and it's funny stuff. And it's always fun to entertain someone, to get that laughter and to hear people get what you just said, because there's always that little second with some of Mel's jokes that they don't get it, and then they get it, and just that little pause is delicious.
I love what you do with that, because you're not scared to stop. I mean, I've seen you in this twice. I saw Nathan Lane do it, of course. He was the big guy who came in originally. There was a kind of a false start to this show, because it was meant to be an actor who was pulled out before it even opened, and then Nathan came over and did it, and it couldn't have been a bigger launch because Lee Evans was in it,
right?
And he's so physical. He perfectly took the role as Leo Bloom, because he's neurotic and he's obsessive compulsive and he has all kinds of funny ways, and Lee could just encapsulate all of that being normal.
Lee's hysterical. I just went up to Wembley in the big inflated tent with 10,000 seats in it, this strange venue, to see Lee's XL tour. Just kills me. He is so funny. And where he gets the energy, I mean.
We're talking today to Fred Applegate, who's playing the big role, Max Bialystock, in probably the world's most successful musical at the moment, because he's just having such a resurgence with adverts for the movie, and everybody's talking about it. I read the Times at the weekend. They gave it a glowing review, the new movie, and you're in it as well.
I am.
Just a little bit, but that must just be such an honor just to be part of something that's going to be around forever.
It was great. I had left the show in the U.S. and had finally gotten to go home to California for a few weeks, and I sort of felt like I was invited to the party, and I was really flattered.
It's a great film, and it's an odd film because it's a film of a musical of a film, so you're kind of watching it. Those soliloquies where they're just doing it to camera, and those moments where they're looking straight on, is kind of almost uncomfortable in a way, but my God, do you pay attention in a theater? It's something I've never really done before. Mm-hmm. It really grabs your attention, doesn't it?
It really does. Really does.
It's in the movies from the 26th of December. I think Mel Brooks is over here now, isn't he? Yeah,
I think so.
Promoting it and talking about it, because it was one of those things that when it launched on Broadway, literally, I was there and didn't really know much about it. And then there was this hoopla that people were paying thousands of dollars to get a ticket. And I don't remember that before. I mean, how often does that happen on Broadway?
That's one of Mel's jokes. The ticket touts, I mean, the scalpers, were charging $400-$600 for the tickets. So Mel decided to make the top price $482. And there's like two seats a night for that price. But he wanted to have the most expensive ticket on Broadway.
That's fantastic.
I'm not even sure they're good seats, but they're $482.
And how are you enjoying being here? Because Broadway's one thing, the West End's another. We've been through a difficult time, obviously, since 77. How have you fitted in? How are you liking London? How are you feeling in the West End?
I'm loving London. I've been here since April, and I'm starting. It's interesting for an American to come over here, because you speak a very similar language to, I wouldn't say you speak what we speak, or we don't speak what you speak, but I'm learning it. I'm also learning certain hand gestures that don't mean the same thing.
Would you like to try one
out? No, thank you. This is radio, so I probably could. But I'm learning it's a lot about the differences in the culture and the society, and it's fascinating, because it's you're not us.
No, we're very different, aren't we?
But you are.
Still close in many ways.
Yeah.
We're all human. This show, then, we're going to come back and talk more after the news, but congratulations on your role in it, because it's just so enjoyable. Theatre is very expensive. They're blaming 7-7. I said earlier, and I'll say it to your face, I think the tickets are very, very expensive for most normal people. Mm-hmm. If you're coming from the north, a 40 quid train ticket plus a 50 quid ticket makes it nearly £100 plus a dinner. It's expensive, this show, you do get value for money because it's so big.
Well, it cost £5 million before the door opened. Before anybody bought the first ticket, they had spent £5 million. So there, it's a big risk.
Did you invest in this show?
If only.
Because, of course, that's one of the lines from the musical, which, of course, is ironic. You're watching this thing which is about never put money into a musical, never be part of a musical. Mm-hmm. And, of course, if this had been a flop, it would have been a bit embarrassing, really, wouldn't it?
Well, yeah.
Fred Applegate's come to us tonight from the theatre, or Drury Lane, where he stars in The Producers, which is a Mel Brooks masterpiece, and it goes from strength to strength, and it's not a particularly healthy time in the West End, although it's one of the biggest times of the year, yet this show still seems to get all the talkability that everybody dreams of in theatre. People just seem to come out talking about it, and that must be so important.
Yeah, it is. When I leave the theatre at night and I walk past people on the street, they're just so excited that they saw it, And it's almost as if they want to convince me that they did enjoy it. I loved it. I loved it. And I said, you know what? I believe you.
How is it being in a show every night where the gag is coming and you know what's coming and keeping it fresh? I mean, we touched on it earlier, but is that tricky? Because every show to me is different. I get to talk to nice, different people every night, like you. You come in and then it's another guest and another guest. But you're working, although it may seem original every night, hopefully, you are working with the same old gags every night. How do you keep it fresh?
Well, you're working with a different audience every night. So you have to take the same material and make it work for that group of people. And that's a challenge. And, you know, it's funny, we talk about people have repetitive jobs where they go into work and they do the same thing day after day. I do exactly the same thing day after day. I long for the variety of, like, screwing something together.
Instead of screwing up, I suppose.
Exactly.
What is it about your career, then, that made you want to come to this? Because so many have tried and so many have failed, quite frankly. This isn't a show where you can half do it. You either got it or you haven't, it seems to me. Mm-hmm. Even on Broadway, people's names have been up there one day and the next day they're gone.
Yeah.
I mean, was this always... when you saw it...
That mine won't be gone on Thursday. It's just quite... You know, it can happen anytime.
I always say every time I come into this building, when that card swipes and it opens the door, I say, thank you, Jesus.
That little green light.
Another day, another paycheck.
Well, when I get to the theater every night, I always look at the marquee to make sure my name is still there. You think I'm kidding.
That must be a thrill, though, also, being in the theater or Drury Lane, because it's the oldest theater and the most renowned, isn't it?
It is. And, you know, not that anybody cares, but I've been a big fan of David Garrick, who was a 19th century actor manager who actually ran the Theater Royal Drury Lane since I was in high school, and now I'm working in his theater.
So why did you want to do this production?
Because it's hysterical. You know, this is the best part on Broadway for a character actor. It doesn't get better than this. So I would chew through a door to do this part.
I did say to somebody, actually, when I was doing interviews on Broadway, that where do you go from here? It was Gary Beach, who plays Hitler and plays Elizabeth Debris. And I said to him, how can you ever top this? And that's got to be a worry for you, hasn't it, really? I mean, how do you beat it?
You know, you just go on to the next thing, the next challenge, the next thing. And whatever comes next is going to be that much more fun because I've had this.
But there aren't that many roles where you're this important in a show.
No. And I love being important because I have children, so I know for a fact I'm not.
And they do the best to remind you.
They remind me every day.
Listen, it's been great talking to you today. Congratulations on the movie as well, because it's such a well-made movie and made very quickly as well. I believe it was only this year that you filmed it, wasn't it?
Actually, I worked on it in March and I came here in April.
I mean, that's unheard of, isn't it, in movies, that they turn it around so quickly?
Well, it was a brand new studio in Brooklyn where they built Broadway. They built 45th Street from Broadway to the river in this studio. So they had all the room they needed and they could move pretty quickly.
Do Sardis pay for the advertising of all the shops and restaurants?
I don't know. But it's right there across the street.
When you see a 9-foot sign for Sardis and you think that's the kind of publicity you can't buy, isn't it?
I wonder if that's product placement. I wonder if they've thought of that on Broadway. I'm sure they have. Somebody's thought of it.
Listen, send my best to all of the cast at the Theatre Royal Drury Lane for the producers. I wish you all the best. What's next? I mean, is there anything coming or anything anywhere that could beat this? Because, I mean, you're the star of probably the biggest musical in America at the moment, and it certainly is in the West End as well. I mean, where can you go from this?
I don't know. Now I'm depressed. I'll stay here.
How are you finding London, by the way, and living in Britain?
I love it. It's a great city. And the culture and the people and just charming and relaxing, and I really do enjoy London.
You see, I'm a foreigner like yourself. I'm from the north. So when I come down here and look at the buildings, it is beautiful. I mean, don't get me wrong, the tourists annoy me and I'm sick of the emergency stop. Do they do that in front of you, by the way?
Oh, yeah.
The little Japanese people, and they just stop.
Well, I still do it. You know, you'll turn a corner and you'll look at, like, the curve, or you'll think, this looks exactly like London. It's exactly like London should look.
How's the family enjoying it?
Oh, terrific. My youngest son and my wife are here with me. My older two, one's in... works for a newspaper in Korea, and my daughter's in college, so they get here whenever they can. We're all going to be here for Christmas, though, so we're really looking forward to that.
That's a tricky schedule, isn't it? Don't they make you do more shows?
okay, they'll be here for Christmas and I'll be working. Now, fortunately, Christmas is on a Sunday, so we'll get it one way or the other.
Listen, congratulations again, and send my all the best to Mel Brooks. I just love the show and I can't do enough to promote it because it's the first musical that made me cry with laughing.
Yeah, me too.
And that open mouth thing. And they show it in the show where people are outraged, but it wasn't that I was outraged. I was just so gobsmacked by the bigness of it. Yep. And I think I said to you the last time I interviewed you that for a man to take the time to build a second set, a different color for one joke, giving it away.
Well, that's Mel.
It's phenomenal, isn't it?
Yeah. No effort is too great to make one joke pay off.
The movie opens on Boxing Day, starring Nathan Lane and Matthew Broderick and Will Ferrell, and also Uma Thurman,
right,
who plays Ula.
Right.
And
she's very tall.
Did you get to work with her?
I didn't. I did work with her. I spent a lot of time staring at her and then being embarrassed. And I did notice we bumped into each other back in the dressing room area, and she was wobbling down the hall because she was in her outfit for the first time. And I asked her if she was okay. She said, they're having me wear heels. I never wear heels. I'm too tall. Because, you know, Ula's got to be as tall as possible. She said, I never wear heels. I can't dance in these. So she was very funny, actually.
One of the lines that I love to nick from the producers, there's many of them, actually, but is where you're on the couch and you say, I may be sitting down, but I'm giving you a standing ovation.
Standing ovation.
Good to talk to you today, Fred Applegate, the star of The Producers. And thanks for coming to see my show.
Oh, it's my pleasure.